Peter Homitzky. I'm a painter, primarily of landscapes, but not a traditional landscape painter. My primary concerns with landscape painting are in the alteration of scale and vantage. To me, they're both variable. And what I try to get out of my pictures is that once you pass a point of reference, it's now behind you. It's like driving into a landscape. So you're dealing only with what's in front of you, not what you've been through already. It's a somewhat a formalist approach. It's certainly not a realist one. Realism is a speed bump as far as art's concerned. I come out of a West Coast tradition of using an expressionist vocabulary, but with recognizable imagery. I've had some success. I've been able to survive through it. I've been involved with about 30 years now with painting landfills, not as horror stories of the detritus of our culture, but as form in relation to the activity going around them, because they are alive, they are functioning. Part of me, even though I'm not interested in documenting anything, this transition, or the energy generated by this transition, is of enormous interest to me. That's what I've been doing for the last few decades. The other thing that I've done for many years has been the tow lines. The tow line is the line in the middle of a road, of a highway. Either yellow or white lines, they're called tow lines. And using them as a metaphor for movement, I've divided my time between the city and that part of upstate New York for over a quarter of a century, but now I'm there full time. So even though I still revisit the Meadowlands in New Jersey and I'm still painting it, it's become much less of a focus for me than it used to be. And now I'm finding kind of the same energy and vitality in the sort of the changing industrial sites that are in upstate New York. I guess that change is a big part of my work. I didn't mean for it to do that, but that's sort of how it came out. It's sort of a contradiction of a formal approach to painting, which I've always felt was necessary to have any kind of relevance in painting. You know, I'm a firm believer that if something is a picture of something, it's probably not a work of art. The idea of trying to keep it as a work of art, but also to be site-specific is, let me put it this way, it took the most of my time for the last 30 years or so. I don't know where it's going. People like Peter Frank and Christopher Youngs and Alejandro Andres have done essays on my work, Hilton Kramer, others, some got it, some didn't. But it had been taken seriously by some people, which has allowed me to survive as a painter without having to support it by other means. I feel very fortunate that that's the case. I feel a little bit out of sorts with the current art world, but I think I always have. Everything I learned about painting and art history has not reinforced it or diminished it. It just is. It's information that I've processed but have not applied to my own painting. So that, I don't know what that means. The best that I've heard from people is when I've been told a number of times that people who have driven through the New Jersey meadows many, many times have looked at it differently after seeing my paintings. That's, I think, the best compliment I could get, that they're beginning. I try to get people to look at things the way I do, without having to explain it, using a solely visual language. And to a large extent, I've reached an audience that I think the audience that I wanted to reach, which is essentially an educated middle class. it has to have a logic, but that logic has to be tied to a self-indulgence. Or it should be, it's self-indulgent, but it has to be tied to a logic, whichever way you want to take it. Exhibiting, well, when you make something, you want to show it, at least to your peers, or people you perceive to be your peers. That's part of the deal, but the life is in the making of it. It's a way of living emotionally in a parallel universe. In other words, when I was a kid, I asked a lot of artists. I was lucky enough to meet a lot of people that my contemporaries only read about, but I got to know them. I didn't want to help from them in the art world. I never asked for that. I didn't want to learn from them how to do it. What I wanted to know is what motivated them. Because face it, making art is a hell of a thing for a grown-up to do. You know, kids are naturally turned on. But certain people feel that they can't function in what you might call the real world. So they have to make an alternative universe for themselves. That allows them to sort of fake everyday life, you know, put one foot in front of the other. They've all kind of said the same thing, although at the time I thought that they were romanticizing their existence. Today I know exactly what they meant. Having come of age in the 60s and formed, I didn't respond that well to my chronological contemporaries. I thought that the generation preceding us dealt with visual issues on a larger scale. Of course, I'm probably the first generation that pretty much came out of academic art schools. My own feeling is that art never should have gone to college. Always try to remember why you got into it in the first place, rather than what it can do for you. It will change. I think that the people who feel enriched by works of art aren't going to go away. I would like to see the prices become a little bit more, it's become too much of a money game. And, you know, I don't care who did it. You know, no work of art, I mean, when they say priceless, you know, well, I have a lot of troubles putting priceless and Andy Warhol into the same. I knew him slightly through Alice Neal, who was a good friend. And we've got to get past this idea that if it's ugly, it's serious. We've had 75 years of that now. An artist's function is to reinvent the world to their own, I hate to use the words like vision, but it's a way of articulating the world that you'd like to live in. Art has lost its narrative quality because other media does it so much better. You can't have a message in a painting. It'll have the impact of a bumper sticker. You know, it's pointless to say, well, what about Goya? Goya was dealing with an illiterate and an immobile public, as was Daumier. Today you see the whole world on television. So art has to be about itself, about experience, about solitude, about putting yourself through somebody else's head into a very different experience than you would have yourself. That's what art does. That's its strength. And there'll always be people who, for whom it's a survival mechanism. They create a world that they are comfortable in, And if the skill is there and the integrity is there, other people will find it also and agree with them. I have, from personal experience, and I've been doing this from some 40-odd years, my experiences with it have been good. There were hard times, of course, but ultimately everything worked the way it's supposed to. You know, most things are meant to work. It's humans that prevent things from working. Everything works if you let it. It has to be your own purpose. If you can satisfy yourself, you probably can satisfy other people.
Well, you know, it used to be easy. A lousy job that you didn't care about gave you enough money to survive. Like, I worked for Fairchild Publications. I took home $55 a week. My rent was $50 a month. My tuition at the league was $50 a month. So that left me roughly $60 of walking around money for the month. And, you know, occasionally I'd get 20 bucks from my parents, but that's another story. But you could survive then. And everybody who worked at Fairchild, the best thing about working there was I had to sit by a ticker tape machine Wednesday and Friday nights when the two trade papers that I worked for went to bed. And then they had blank spaces. And I had to take something off the ticker tape and shoehorn it into those blank spaces. That was two evenings a week, and I had to stay till it was done. But the rest of the week, they didn't care when I came, when I left, how long we took for lunch. You know, all of that. We went to gallery openings on 10th Street every Friday night. We used to call them galleries because they used to serve gala wine. But that's, you know, that's where we met women. Most of the women I met were at the Modern, which was a clubhouse then. It was empty. And I would grab the ashtray. They were in the doorways and go in the middle of the room and sit on the floor and watch buttocks go by of these women that were, you know, kept women that used to spend their day in the Modern. And they liked nothing better than young artists during the day. So that was the life we had. Gallery openings, poetry readings, music, you know, the five spot on Monday nights when Monk played. It was the real New York. It was a continuation. And it started changing with Lindsay. He made lofts legal, so everybody lost their loft because now the bougies wanted them. All those great cheap restaurants closed or became expensive. And New York wasn't livable anymore. After the 60s, it was kind of a downward slope. And I finally left New York when the rent of my loft was about to quintuple. I moved to Elizabeth, New Jersey first and built a loft there. But of course, then they wanted to tear the building down for a supermarket. And so that's the same thing in Hoboken. There were 40 studios across the street from me, which is now the Grand Adams, which is a grossly overpriced rental. I mean, they cut all the lofts up into little cubicles for Wall Streeters. Now it's a one industry town. There are no artists left in Hoboken except two that I know of. So it was time to leave there too.
You see, what I did was I compressed the landscape here between the lighthouse and the cement plant. I put that big cement plant almost directly behind that tower, the tank. And what that does, it twisted the landscape a little bit. I still kept the integrity of the bridges, but of course you can see far less. And I combined what you can see from about a quarter of a mile where there's a break in the island directly to the city of Hudson. So it's like right over there, but I included it in the painting anyway. So it creates a very different dynamic, but it's still very site specific. Anyone who knows this will recognize it instantly, but it's different in the painting. What I would say to a young artist today is to develop a personal viewpoint. And that is, you personalize your experience in a way that you can articulate it truthfully enough that another person will be able to share that experience. That's very different from style. Style is always something that you borrow from someone else. A viewpoint is you personalize your being. You flesh out a picture in a way that it can mean something. And in the history of the world, and this is something with this current realist revival, comes from two reasons. Kids are raised by computers today, and they're losing their ability to visualize. It's all pre-digested for them. They react. They're made into consumers of images rather than the generators of images.